think you are referring to something like, can we build something that is secure by design, probably. So by design, because if security is added as something extra on top of something already has been built, that may not gel well. And probably most of the attacks we see nowadays is due to that gap that is there. Yes, I think, I personally feel automated reasoning as it is evolving now can come in there. So you see, in case of crypto, we have this notion of provable security, right? So if we can go about this, but if we look at the provable security that is being practiced now, it is mostly, you know, human driven. So we sit, we sit with some certain assumptions, we try to derive certain things, and finally we have a proof ready maybe, and these are the guarantees we want to provide. But if there could be a tool that would enable us to do this, I think that would be great. I would like to cite something here. For example, you all know about this advanced encryption standard, right? And when the designers of AES had proposed it, they gave a theoretical guarantee that 4 rounds of AES would be immune to certain kinds of differential attack. Now, that was a theoretical proof using something known as the white trail design strategy. Let's not go into the details. But then, many years later, actually, one Belgian researcher, Nicky Mouhoua, he actually came up with a nice idea of using automated tools like MILP, mixed integer linear programming, and he could, using a solver, show that the same guarantee can be automatically proven. So that is a very nice example of something that, you know, where an automated tool chips in and confirms something that was achieved by humans before. And interestingly, the automated tools not only reconfirms that idea, it also extends. Now you can do it, you can just scale it up. You can do it for any number of rounds, not only 4, go further and show each of these results. Now, as Professor Gupta was mentioning, of course, these kind of tools will have constraints. So you cannot always scale it to any level you want. But having this kind of automated tools, if they can give us some kind of guarantee when we code. So maybe a developer is developing something and later on he just runs a tool and it just tells him that, okay, these are certain points of interest in your code which might lead to some vulnerability. Now, if I can put in another interesting attacks, that is known as the side channel attacks, which actually exploit implementation vulnerabilities. For example, there is a code which is imbalanced in terms of timing. So you can do some kind of timing analysis to retrieve some information from there. So even in that case, automated reasoning can come in handy. In fact, people are coming out with tools which can design, you can have tools which give RTL code, that is the code that is finally fabricated into a chip, which can be shown to be secure against some kind of side channel attacks. So I think I would completely agree with you regarding the fact that automated reasoning can come in very, very handy in filling this gap between of capacity building that exists currently in India and probably also abroad. And I would also agree that there is actually some concentrated effort that happens, and the dissipation could happen better if we have this kind of automated tools. Now, coming to your second question, where you are mentioning about can automated tools help us maybe mitigating attacks like the Triconex hack that you mentioned. So maybe I will give the audience a brief overview about that attack. So the Triconex attack was actually, it's called the Triton. You can Google it maybe. It's called the Triton attack. And it was actually an attack on a Schneider Electric tool known as Triconex. Okay. And what was the main intention? The main intention was to actually lead to a catastrophic failure in case of a industrial automation system. So in this case, the target country was Saudi Arabia, and it was mostly the petrochemical industry that was being targeted. Okay. And the interesting part is every organization that works on this kind of large-scale industrial automation systems who have a lot of safety in place, they go with something known as layered security. So you have various layers in your security. First of all, you would like to isolate your network from the internet. That would be your first layer of security. Maybe you use some kind of firewall to do that. Then after that firewall, that is like your first line of defense, you go inside and then you try to put up something like you want to isolate, completely isolate the plant network that might be, your petrochemical plant, which is on a network. You are isolated further. Okay. So these kind of layered security is available. Access control mechanisms are in place. But what the hackers did in this case was they had invested a lot of time. This particular attack was discovered in 2017 upon a minor investigation. But the research into it reveals that the attack had started as early as 2014. So the hackers had the motivation and time to have a multi-year concentrated effort to breach the system. And what was the primary breach point was a misconfigured firewall. Now, I think that's a very important point. The misconfigured firewall. Herein, I think automated reasoning tools can come in very handy. Because see, we configure stuff, but we may not know whether that configuration can lead to some state transition to a vulnerable state. Okay, but if an automated tool can prove this thing, if we use automated theorem proving to come to a state which shows us that, okay, this configuration is best suited for this, then I think this kind of very, very catastrophic failures can be avoided. Now, of course, Trichonex is not an isolated incident. We have a lot of attacks that we can actually talk about. For example, I think most of us would be familiar with the Stuxnet attack. Stuxnet, which was actually targeted towards the Iranian nuclear program. And also it led to almost 1/5 of the centrifuges to be failed. So it was there the target was PLCs. So we can see that there is an effort from the attackers to target cyber physical systems like SCADA or other kind of PLCs, okay, where they would like to gain remote access. Similar examples can be the Havex attack that was on the they wanted to have a remote access Trojan so that they could remotely trigger certain things, and it was again targeted to the petrochemical industries in European and US, Europe and Canada. Probably Triton is one of the very, very good examples that we can see that should open our eyes that this kind of systems cannot be manually protected. We need some kind of assistance, if not complete proof, means if not completely automated, we need some kind of machine assistance here. And I think automated tools may be the starting point of getting to the Holy Grail. Yeah,
Devan. Thank you so much, Professor Sah. No, I agree completely. That's one of the reasons why I brought it up, because you know, if you have so many humans, different subgroups setting up routers in different places, configuring them differently over a period of years, and when you have hackers, in many cases nation state backed, and in many cases backed by long-term criminal syndicates that are willing to put in that amount of effort, you need something that can help humans do this better. So now I'll come to Ashutosh one more time. Dhiman brought up side channel attacks and stuff like that, right? There's some crazy stuff out there, right? You know, you have Daniel Genkin's, acoustic cryptanalysis style attacks and sort of very strange static electricity stuff. Yeah. Can automated reasoning model some of the, like, as long as we can model this, can we put it into the system, or what are the limitations there?
So in automated reasoning, the first thing is that in any analysis of any system, you need to model it, okay? And modeling is never perfect. This has often people who are trying to do verification, they always say, why can't you be exactly model? No, you can't model accurately anything in the world, okay? So models always approximate. There's a famous saying, you know, if a map is so accurate, it will be as large as, you know, the thing itself. So what's the point of having a map? You can't hold it in your hands, okay? So the models will approximate anyway. But the question is, it should capture the relevant features. For example, in acoustics, you need to, or static, you need to model electromagnetism and physical attribute of the device accurately and reasonably enough. I mean, you don't want to go to the quantum level, but you know, you need to get to the right level of abstraction and not throw away unnecessary details. Okay. And that's the hardness. That's where the smarts lie. When you make a company or a research group, which try to solve these problems, they have to find the right level of abstraction or right level of modeling description of a system such that a verification tool can work on it. Okay. Once you model in the right level, then you give it to a analysis tool, and model is, then it will tell the given property, you know, somebody cannot steal my password, unfair access, things like that. But for example, this misconfiguration example can be checked. But if your model is wrong, for example, you did not model that how many ways your firewall can be misconfigured. I mean, you need to somehow model the lock on the door also. Okay, if somebody, some employee of you, I was asked to audit a system, and the first thing I went there, who has access to the door? And apparently there was a fridge in there inside this next to the server, and everybody can go in and open the fridge. So that kind of, would you model fridge in your system model? Okay. So if you put too much detail, let me get back to the idea of why don't we just model and put a lot of detail in it. If you put too much detail, subsequent analysis, it becomes impossible. It's just so detailed that a verification or analysis tool will just bog down. It won't be able to do anything. So what you need to do is you feed in the right amount of information and then move on. Okay. So that's where your smarts lie, you know, choose the right level of description.
Okay. Thank you so much. I think that's a problem we'll have to fight for a very long time to come, infinitely. But Vinayak, I want to get to you with a slightly more industry focused question. You know, we've been talking all this time about sort of security in some sense, just plain old, not plain old, it's plain now also, security. But obviously, as automated as systems grow more and more complex, more and more people are going to start using automated reasoning if they're not doing so already. And at some point, you're going to have regulators and cyber insurance companies and sort of everyone else who wants to interface with these systems come in. So where do you see the future for this in India? Like, are you hoping that, you know, the government will come in and say all systems that are in critical infrastructure must satisfy ABCD guarantees? Or do you see cyber insurance companies coming in and doing some kind of scoring? Or do you see industry bodies such as your own trying to impose some kind of, some kind of security best practices system? Sorry, Vinayak, you're still muted.
What I see from the industry perspective is, on one hand, somebody who is managing those system, managing those innovation, has to take care of the entire digitization requirement. On other hand, the obligations are rising. They're becoming very specific. Just look at the new data protection bill, which is coming in. So each of the expectation has been now very granularly specified there, basically, and you need to do, means if you have to really comply with some of the requirement, you need to do a lot of process overhauling as well. And these liabilities are not only the outcome based or liability. For example, if breach happens, then because of breach happens, the data subject got harmed, and that's why you have to pay some fine or some kind of compensation. It also happening, liability is also coming to procedural level. Means while executing a particular transaction, you need to adhere to this kind of a requirement. This kind of expectation needs to be met at a procedural level as well. So the liabilities and obligations are coming at outcome level and the procedural level as well. And on the other hand, we are unbundling the way we process the transaction. So for example, if you take a financial transaction industry, there are a lot of fintechs joining the transaction processing. There are a lot of those players, even the social media players, are now taking part in terms of initiating transaction, like a Google or even Facebook now. And there are so many such new players, new system, new interfaces, new capabilities that are sourced from the cloud. Then you decompose the larger process into multiple small microservices to become more modular and more innovative in the sense. And each of the microservices can be supported by different capability provider as well. So that is how the entire ecosystem is going on one hand. On the other hand, we are seeing the compliance and obligations are becoming more and more specific, more and more granular. And the overall subject matters of the compliance, be it security or privacy, has been rising quite significantly and becoming more specific, basically. And in this particular case, security used to have a deterministic way of looking, right? For example, you define the policy, and then you, based on this policy, you try to adhere or impose those policies, basically. So sometimes in the coming ecosystem, it will be very difficult for you to really even devise the policy for a scenario which could be difficult from the security perspective to probably to be stand with the new attacks which is coming in, and the scale and complexity and persistence of that attack which is coming in. On the other hand, there are new regulations which are coming in, new obligations which are coming in. So sometimes you would be very, very difficult to manage or probably look at those kind of, give those kind of context to take those decisions which are secure, which are decisions for made for security or made for the compliance basically. So sometimes these policies that you determine and you use to enforce those policies to for better governance and better security, you will be very it will be very difficult for you to really define them now. So the one important application of automated reasoning is probably it can help you to mathematically evolve the policies from the all the equations which is coming in, and probably probably define those policies. So now the experiment that Amazon is trying with this Jelkova kind of tool, which is open source code available for this one, is trying to see, can we evolve policy in the operating cycle of security? Because operating cycle of security is now becoming more challenging. We may have a lot of things talked about in design process, but operating environment is different. There will be millions of situations, and those situations, the security system will behave securely and it will also comply with the requirement, but there could be one situation the system may behave abruptly basically, and that situation you may not be thinking when you're designing the system, may not be thinking when you're defining the policy basically. So can this automated reasoning ecosystem, which is a mathematical science, help you to define those policy on the fly? Can system itself can define that automatic, can it reason basically? And the decision making is very important, because this reason that you evolve for taking a that particular security compliance decision, can it be evolved during the course of time by looking at all those events, all those ecosystem, all those kind of data which is coming up to you? And can it also, another important part of security requirement is ki it should be provable for the various reason. Compliance reason is definitely important reason, but for forensic reason as well, investigation reason as well, for example. And there are a lot of other areas which are coming from the perspective of the a lot of those ethical norm, moral issues which are coming from, and you need to stand with them as well. So can system automatically reason out of the data that it's find? Can it really, and that is how the industry will be looking at how to manage all of those kind of complexities, manage all of those kind of requirement. And to that particular one point, which is increasingly the context that is required to process that one point is increasingly becoming significantly more and voluminous. So making it to human to define this policy will be very difficult. So can system find its own way of policies and basically impose that? So that is how the industry would like to see, and that's how I see at least some big player like Amazon and some of the Indian players, big players like I know I had been discussing similar kind of players like a Jio. So they have been looking at such kind of possibilities and such kind of capabilities.
Great. So I'm going to go back to Ashutosh with on this sort of can who watches? I mean, this obviously can't boil down to nothing. Who watches the watchman at some point? But can we have some kind of kernel of basic policies beyond which the system learns and evolves, not necessarily on its own, but along some best practices routes in some sense?
Yeah.
And if you could talk a little bit about that, and then I'd like maybe both you and Dhiman to comment upon what happens after. In some sense, do you see a future where, let's say, HIPAA laws or safe harbor style laws can say, oh, you can transfer data from here to here, or you can perform these operations as long as these guarantees are met. In some sense, could automated reasoning become some kind of platform upon which we can now do things that weren't allowed before due to certain legal restrictions? So if you could comment upon both of those. First, so, Ashutosh.
Okay, so yeah, so this is what we call automated, a step higher than automated reasoning, automated synthesis, okay? Where you simply say, tell, I want to make a car, and it's this big, this high, this speed, and car design on its own. And so far, this is fiction. I mean, it's not possible yet. But at some small level, it is already being done. Okay. So a lot of automated, like for example, device drivers in your laptop. Some of them are automatically generated. You just simply write down what you want to do. Okay. And the actual code which runs on a machine is auto-generated from your properties. Okay, so earlier you were writing a code and then writing a property and then checking against each other. Now you simply write the property and it goes in. It is in a very nascent state technology and very, very potentially useful. Okay, because if this works, okay, so then you don't need to manually go and configure your firewall. All you need to do is describe in a high level descriptions and then firewall gets generated, configuration files auto generated. This is actually very simpler implication of this capability. Okay, this is actually already possible. Actually, it's yet deployed in a large scale. People are afraid it's auto generation because auto generation has this problem. How do you trust this auto generation tool? Okay, what if it has a bug? Okay, that's what you mentioned. Then who will watch the watchers? Okay, and so trust. How do you trust this automated system? So what do we do is that you build this verification tool or synthesis tool which checks to something else, and you build something which checks this thing. And hopefully, then you build something which checks this thing. And hopefully this component which checks the final thing is small enough that you human can read in a single page, okay? And it does happen. So for example, when I build a verification tool, I build verification tool, verification tool checker, and it's checker. Okay, and after three steps, it usually gets too small to humanly check. So, so that's how should I say that you can achieve this kind of a high level automation. Okay, where you know you gave this example. You know, okay, like Amazon, in a lot of places, people are making very various different decisions. How do you put all these together? Okay, and that's where these people can communicate instead of via code and protocols. They can communicate via policies, and they can separate the concerns. And then say, as long as you comply with that policy, I'm good. If I follow the policy, you should be good. And that's the actually the principle was when internet was developed. But now internet is a hostile place. Okay, so that is not assumption holds true. I mean, this has been a long, it's an old story. Okay, but let me tell you one interesting story. So there was once. So the internet, which says that I have, let's say, Facebook. Okay, how do you know where to find Facebook? There is a protocol which tells you, and it's unsecured protocol. So anybody, I can actually in my computer can say that I have Facebook. Okay, it's only trust basis that you know that everybody will be honest about it. So one day, Facebook, Pakistani government declared, you know, YouTube is banned. So their ISP said, how should I implement this? He said, I will declare I have the YouTube. And all the traffic will come to me and I will ignore it. So what happened? Whole world, half of the world thought YouTube is in Pakistan. So half of the world's traffic was going in the Pakistan and it was not working. So that kind of, you know, it, as you said, a small thing can cause big things. Okay. So maybe, yes, YouTube.
Yeah, I remember that incident. It's hilarious. Like Tokyo lost access to YouTube, and Basically, I mean, many of the people watching presumably will be quite surprised at the way it was solved. The internet is so ad hoc. It was basically mid-level technical operators phone calling each other in order to solve this issue, and that happened fortunately fairly quickly. But yeah, that was a fascinating incident. But maybe if you could comment a bit more on the second part of my question about, you know, let's say we have more use of automated reasoning over time. What new opportunities do you see? Like I mentioned safe harbor or something like that. Could you see regulators allowing new things that they wouldn't allow before as long as you met guarantees?
Of course, yes. So the problem, so regulators have been constantly interested. Like for example, this level 7, you know, you often go, say level 7, you need to do formal verification. And they come to people, often companies come to me, I want to formally verify this box. So if I can do that, my regulator will allow me. But the problem is they often misunderstand how difficult the problem is, and they misinterpret the requirements. And at the end, it's in paper, it's level 7, but it's not really. So so if we can communicate, so actually that's what we say that. Currently, the technology to develop new formal methods technology, you need to PhD. To use a formal method technology, you also need a PhD. Okay, but this is not good state of affairs. So you need a master's level people can able to really, you know, use it. So if that happens, if that kind of technological landscape builds up, of course, I mean, there's huge potential. So many things can be done, which are currently completely disallowed. Okay. For example, you know, you cannot buy electricity on the street. Okay, there's a big reason. I mean, you can see the legal reason in India why they don't allow it. But if you can formalize these things and why they are doing it, then you'll see that there is a way to do it. But regulators are afraid, and yeah. So if automated reasoning is there, then they can be convinced more that no, this is where I'm doing things better.
Okay, and yeah, you definitely don't want PhDs in charge of everything. I think the what's the full form? Permanent head damage. So Dhiman, if you could also comment on this point, because I think this is something where we need a lot of discussion. So let's say as this technology moves forward, how do you see it evolving? And I'll ask you to also focus on India a little bit if possible. Mm-hmm. What ends up happening in your opinion?
So I think the one of the most important bottlenecks of this kind of a tool is scalability, I guess. That is, does it scale? So what I feel is equally challenging is to adapt it to something that we as a community or as a society are moving towards. So if you look at the current state of the art in terms of communication or technology, we see that we are moving towards what many people love to call as Internet of Everything, right? And so we have not only, you know, people, so when you talk about access policies now, if I think about automated tool, you know, and access policy, so I can bring up this example of Ericsson. So Ericsson, what it does is that it uses automated tools to generate best configuration. So Ericsson sells this telecom devices throughout the world, and every geographical entity that it sells it to has a different set of requirements and different set of regulations, different set of requirements in terms of security and so on and so forth. Now, for every such thing, what Ericsson does is that it uses the automated tool to generate a best configuration. And of course, this looks good up to a particular level, but when we scale it up to a level where every, you know, node, so you see, when you talk about, so our topic of discussion is security decision making, right? So if you look at today's world of the Internet of Everything, everything is sensor driven. So you are taking decisions basing on some sensor data that is coming to you, and you might take some kind of decisions which could also impact a, you know, human life. It could be at that level. Okay, so my probably concern is, can this kind of a system scale to that level where any kind of, you know, small device that is joining and leaving the network. So the 5G technology allows for trillions of devices to get connected and leaving the network as we go, on the go. So can this technology be scaled? And if it can be scaled, I think that is going to be our, you know, best part. Now, the thing that you're asking, that whether regulatory bodies will be happy, I think I'll absolutely agree with Professor Gupta here. Definitely, if there is a way to show that certain things will work, then regulators will be very happy to do that. In fact, prior to this, you had, I think you raised this question of cyber insurance, I think, if I am not wrong. And I think this brings me to that point, that what is the residue? So see, we are trying to give some guarantee here that this system is secure up to if this kind of thing is enabled or given certain constraints. Now, but there could be a place where it may fail. It may still fail. And if it does fail, then what kicks in? So that is where insurance comes into the picture. So even if even the last of the fail-safes fail, then what will happen? And if I look into the current literature on cyber insurance, I can see that most of the cyber insurance is a bit qualitative in nature. That means, so maybe you are an expert on a particular field and I am the insurance company and a client comes in, I will seek your advice. How do you judge that system? And what do you think I can base my premium on about its level of, you know, the vulnerability that system may be exposed over the next year? Okay, but then again, if I look at this qualitative analysis, a qualitative study, this is subjective, right? One expert might give some view, another might give some other view. Herein, I think automated tools can be very, very helpful. So if we can come up with some kind of modeling of this kind of a system, again, all this thing is within quotes, that given the model is right, as Professor Gupta rightly mentioned, it all bases on the model, then probably this kind of cyber insurance can be more quantitative, and it, you know, it can be based on certain mathematical inferences rather than being subjective conclusions. So, but I will absolutely agree with you on the fact that if this kind of system can become a reality, acceptable reality by the regulatory bodies, then of course we will be able to do stuff then that perhaps currently we are not allowed to do, not because they're not possible, but because of the fact that they cannot guarantee certain things about those.
Yeah, I mean, although every time I hear Internet of Things or Internet of Everything, and I just imagine 10,000 thin clients in my house, I'm just like, no, we're not going in that direction. I've seen some of the code that runs on these things. I don't want them anywhere near me. So we're pretty much out of time. I'll go to Vinayak just to wrap up. I think we've had a good sort of long-term discussion about directions of movement and what happens after all of this. But I think it's also good if you could give us a little bit of overview. You're probably the person with the most sort of direct industry know-how right now. You're sort of hooked into all of these companies. Right now in India, what are the ways in which people are deploying or planning to use automated reasoning? What sort of the immediate low-hanging fruit stuff that they're looking at? Or is this something that's happening in the West and nobody in India is really doing much about it other than just copied stuff?
Yeah, so I see, I think largely at this point of time, Amazon, AWS stocks a lot on the use of automated reasoning and many of their security and compliance offering that security they have, right? So they had been even, they bought some company, startup company working in this area. They had developed some framework. And since last year, I see, especially from the compliance identity management side, Amazon has been significantly talking about it. So I see our unicorns, basically, we have been processing so many transactions and we have seen some of the cases which recently happened in one of the unicorn, basically. Our unicorn, and at least there are some technology-focused unicorn, I see them taking a key interest in such kind of evolutions happening in the mathematics and especially the data science and computer science field, and trying to look at developing solution on top of some of those research work and some of those open source component which has been built as part of this process, basically. The third element I see is the we have been seeing a lot of investment coming from the cloud perspective in the country, and we are now looking at some of the cloud providers like Tata Communication or ControlS, and we are seeing quite a significant investment coming from security side on the cloud providers as well, because they also see a lot of data and they also offer many of those contemporary services there. Another important thing is that the large companies, conventional company like banking ecosystem, where now increasingly they are focusing their attention to the cyber defense centers, basically, CDCs. And one of the important part of CDCs is now orchestration and automation of security. But with the context of this new data protection regulation coming in and some of the expectation of a new law, cyber law, which process already been started, basically, the obligation and the more the specific the obligation, more on the one hand and other hand, the digitization, urge of digitization on the other hand, basically, that will lead to many of the larger conventional companies also to think about such evolution quite seriously. And the last one, which is an important for us as a Data Security Council of India, because I run as a DSA, we run with the Minister of Electronics and IT. There is a National Center of Excellence for Cybersecurity that I had been overseeing, and we are seeing both from technology perspective. For example, in the afternoon, I'll be talking about the something new concept we are looking at, the CSRN, Cybersecurity Research Network. And we are seeing that the research which is happening in industry level, how can we make it work with the industry, basically? And that is one part, and we are trying to look at any new research can be also funded by government, by from the industry as well. We are trying to see how best we can play a role there, basically, in some of this new area which is coming in. We would like also like to see whether we are currently working with ASIPO Center for Cryptology and Cybersecurity on the Lightweight Crypto Challenge. Professor Dhiman helped us in one of the interaction. So can there be some challenge that we can put forward to some of the new areas which is coming in? Can we think about, but for that we need to have data, we need to have collaboration with those players which has that significant level of data. So can we organize a challenge for that? I'm also looking at a possibility of startups. There are some startups which are in a security operation and orchestration business. They are in SIEM business, basically. Some of them have very good deployment base all across the sectors, basically, and data do come to them, and whether the data, they can really use that data to extend some of these kind of capabilities which are coming in, algorithms which are coming in. So that could be another important target that we are looking at. And some of the R&D centers like a CDAC, basically, they have been providing solutions to the larger critical sector organization. and especially we have very good relation with them as well. From there, we are seeing how can they platformize those technologies, and platformization will bring the data to them. Almost the data is there with them. They can probably experiment with some of the new ideas that we are deliberating here.
All right, great. We're exactly 5 minutes over time, so I think we will end things here. Srishti, if there are any admin updates you want to give. Otherwise, that's it from me and the rest of us.
Thank you. Thank you, respected speakers, for sharing your thoughts. So guys, we'll soon begin with our next session. Please stay tuned. Thank you, everyone.